And join me in our call to worship. Welcome, friends, to this special place.
We come to offer thanks. We come to praise our God.
Welcome, friends, to this time set apart.
A time to remember the holy promises we have.
Welcome, friends, to this table of remembrance and joy.
We will come to the table of salvation. Let us now worship God.
Please remain standing and join your voices in our opening hymn, He Leadeth Me, found on page 690 in the hymnal.
Our
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the 15th chapter of the Gospel of John, verses 9 through 17. This scripture is found on pages 939 and 940 of your Pew Bible, John 15, 9 through 17. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends, for all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and appointed you that you should go and bear fruit, and that your fruit should abide, so that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it to you. This I command you, to love one another. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will now sing one verse, Jesus Loves Me, as the children and youth come forward for their special moment.
You're never going to run out as long as the love is coming from God. You're never going to run out of love to share with everyone. All right? Let's say a prayer.
This morning, friendship with Jesus. So before we get into that, let's consider a little bit about what is a friend. These are some statements made at various times by various people. A friend is like a warm bedroll on a cold and frosty night. A friend is a mug of hot coffee on a damp, cloudy day. A friend is like a beautiful oasis in the middle of the desert. A friend is like a hot bath after you've walked 10 miles on a dusty road. All interesting thoughts. I'll end that one with one of Mark Twain's comments on friendship. He said, and I quote, "The holy passion of friendship is of so sweet and steady and loyal and enduring a nature that it will last through a whole lifetime, if not asked to lend money." End quote. Friendship, clearly a wonderful thing. We're all familiar with it. We all have friends. So today, this message is on friendship. Shall we pray? Gracious God, may the words of my lips and the meditations of all our hearts and minds be acceptable in thy sight, Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Many of us may not realize it, may not be aware of it, maybe even never heard it before, but Christians were called friends before they were called Christians. That's right. The New Testament says that it was in Antioch that the disciples were first called Christians. That, of course, is after the time of Christ's death, long after his death, and the disciples had already dispersed out to different areas and whatever, and were forming these new churches. But at Antioch, they first began, the first rendering anyway, the Bible tells us, that they began to be called, the followers of Jesus began to be called Christians. But before, months before, we became known as Christians, Jesus himself said to his disciples, "I have called you friends." This passage we heard this morning. "I have called you friends." Before anything else, Christians were called friends. It's what Jesus called those who were following. So, friendship. Characteristics of friendship this morning. Friends care about each other's welfare, right? If you're my friend, I want the best for you. I want people to think well of you. I want no harm to come to you. In fact, deep friendships are often forged in the midst of suffering, oftentimes common suffering. Soldiers returning from the battlefield will always speak about the ugliness of war and how terrible it is, and oftentimes do not even want to talk about that aspect of their experience at all. And yet, in the same breath, they will talk about the warmth that they have shared and the friends that they made with the others that they served with in the military. And then we see what happens over and over again when a natural disaster hits an area. Whether that be a tornado, an earthquake, a flood, people who might have initially not really known each other at all, they pass through that terrible storm, the aftermath of the storm, the recovery of their area. They work together, and they suddenly feel themselves to be friends. And years later, they'll still sit and reminisce about that shared experience that they all had. So many of you remember the flood of 1993, right here in St. Genevieve. You still hear people share fond stories of the experiences they had after that flood, even here in this church with the basement being flooded and the people that had to man the pumps and had to man the church, and then after that was all over, had to repair the church. I mean, you still hear stories about that, about the camaraderie in this entire community at the time of that great disaster. Even though it's over 30 years ago now that took place. Friendship often requires sacrifice of some sort. And, of course, in extreme cases, in very rare cases, even the supreme sacrifice. There's no greater love than this to lay down one's life for one's friends. A story I had heard long ago, I don't know if I've shared it with this congregation or not, I probably have, as much as I've talked to you over the last 11 years. But anyway, this is a Vietnam War story, which, of course, I grew up in. The Vietnam War was still going on at that time. We heard a lot of stories coming out of Vietnam. But during the Vietnam War, a rural village in South Vietnam had been bombarded with mortar shells. And some of those shells landed on an orphanage that was run by missionaries there. The missionaries and some of the children were killed outright. Several of the other children were wounded, including an 8-year-old girl who had multiple injuries and was still bleeding profusely. In response to a runner that had been sent out from that village to the next village, a young Navy doctor and nurse who happened to be there in that neighboring village came, and all they had were their medical kits with them. So the young girl was in critical condition, and she was in need of a blood transfusion. She'd lost so much blood. But neither the young doctor or the nurse had the blood type of this girl. However, there were several children still there in the village that did have a matching blood type with this young 8-year-old girl. Now, the Navy doctor, he spoke a little bit of pidgin Vietnamese. He'd not been stationed there very long. He spoke a little bit, but not very much, just enough to barely get by. And the nurse had had French in high school, and French of France, if you go back in history, Vietnam was a colony of France for a long time. So French was a language that was taught quite often in Vietnam. So using what language they had, the children didn't speak any English at all, but some of them did know some French, and of course they all knew Vietnamese. Using what language they had, and also using sign language, the nurse and the doctor tried to explain to the children that unless they could replace some of the girl's blood, she was going to die. So they asked the children, would any of you be willing to give some blood so that this girl can live? Well, a wide-eyed silence met their request. And after a moment of eye-searching, a little hand went up slowly, and he pulled it back down, and then he held it up again, volunteering to give blood to the little girl. "Oh, thank you," exclaimed the nurse in French. "What is your name?" "Hing." His name was Hing. He was quickly laid on a pallet, his arms swabbed with alcohol, the needle carefully inserted into his arm, and after a moment he shuddered, he covered his face with his arm. "Is it hurting, Hing?" the nurse asked. Hing shook his head no, but he started crying with his face covered with his arm. During this procedure, a Vietnam nurse arrived to help out. Seeing that Hing was in so much distress, she spoke to him in Vietnamese, listened to him, quickly answered him, stroked his forehead, soothed him a little bit, seemed to reassure him, and after a few moments, he stopped crying. He removed his arms, he opened his eyes, and had a look of relief on his face. looking up, the Vietnamese nurse explained to the American doctor and nurse, Hing thought that he was dying. The children misunderstood you. They thought they had to give all of their blood for the other girl to live. The nurse said, why would he be willing to die for this other girl? The Vietnamese nurse relayed that question to Hing, and Hing answered, because she is my friend. I don't know how many of us have ever had a friend like that. Have you ever had a friend like that? You do have one that I know of. It was on a hill called Calvary outside the city wall overlooking the town dump. It was there that your friend and my friend died that we might live. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend. So, how do you, how do we, how do I get to be Jesus' friend? He tells us right here in this passage that Julie read to us this morning. He says, you are my friend if you do what I command. Okay, well, if we take that out of context, if we just listen to that one little part of Scripture, you're my friend if you do what I command you, you might think, well, we've got to follow all these rules. We've got to do all of these various things that the Bible tells us to do in order to be Jesus' friend. But if you put it in context, Jesus tells you right exactly what he commands you, and it's not a long set of rules and things that we have to follow. He tells us right here in this passage twice. He says, this is what I command you, to love one another as I have loved you. That's what he commands in this passage. When he said, to be my friend, you just follow my command. And it is also in other places in the Bible called the great commandment, the commandment to love one another, just as Jesus has loved us. Now that sounds so simple, but we know that's not very simple at all. And for whatever it's worth, we might come upon this relationship with Jesus willy-nilly, by accident, as Jesus reminded the 12 in the upper room. When they were in the upper room for that first supper, Jesus said, you did not choose me. I chose you. I chose you. Looking around, there are probably some of you in here, like me, that remember the sitcom, The Wonder Years. Now, there was a reboot a few years ago, which was not really nearly as good as the original. The original came out in the 1980s, and my wife and I watched it, and it was one of my favorite shows because it wasn't about me, but it was set from 1968 to 1973. In 1968, I was 12 years old. Kevin, the star of the show, was 12 when it started. So it was the same era I lived through at that same time. Assassinations were still taking place. Bobby Kennedy had just been assassinated. Of course, the first man walked on the moon the next year in 1969. All those things that I related to were in that story. But that story was a coming-of-age story about Kevin and his friend Paul and his other friend Wendy, who later on becomes his girlfriend. And it was a wonderful story, I thought, the stories that they included in that. One episode I remember very clearly, because it also related to me, because it was about basketball. During the winter season, the guys were in middle school. It was junior high for them at that time. And they were always dividing up, and they were picked to be on basketball teams in their PE class. Okay? So, you know, you divide up the PE, and the PE coach says, okay, you're the captains, you pick the teams. Well, Kevin and his friends were always being picked last because they were no good at basketball. They were not athletic at all. And his friends began to complain to Kevin about it. Said, you know, we always get picked last. That's just terrible. So Kevin, being Kevin, went to the coach and said, Coach, you know, we're my friends and I, we feel bad because we always get picked last on the teams to play basketball. And the coach says, well, I'll tell you what, Kevin, you're the next captain. You get to pick. And so the next day they go to class, they're going to play basketball. Kevin is chosen as one of the captains to pick one team, and one of the good players is chosen to pick the other team. So the pressure is on Kevin. The other captain picks one of the other best players in the class. Pressure's on Kevin. What's he going to do? He looks around. He sees the other good players. He sees his friend Paul and some of their other friends standing off to the side. And he chooses Paul, who is probably the worst player in the class. He chooses Paul. The other captain chooses a very good player. Kevin comes around again, and he chooses another one of his friends who's a terrible player. And then the other captain picks another good player. And then Kevin gets ready to choose again, and his two friends say, Kevin, pick some of the good players. We want to win. Come on. Kevin doesn't do it. He picks his friends. He picks the worst players on the team. This entire team is made up of the worst guys on the team. The other team is made up of the best guys on the team. And then they play the game. And what happens? Kevin's team gets slaughtered. They don't win at all. There's no David and Goliath story here. They get slaughtered. That's what happened in real life. But during the game, in the middle of the game, once they realized, you know, we're going to get slaughtered, they just started having fun. They just started playing with abandon, throwing the ball around. They didn't care if they missed a shot. They didn't care if the other team made 10 in a row. They still enjoyed the game. They enjoyed playing. They felt good about it. And Kevin felt good about it. They were not necessarily playing to win. They were playing to enjoy the game and to have fun. If Jesus had wanted to win in the religion game when he was alive here on this earth, he probably should have chosen the Pharisees or the Sadducees. They were the pious people. They were the ones that knew the scriptures of their day. They were the ones that prayed 3 times a day every day. They worked hard at obeying all of God's rules. They were the star players in the religion of their day. But who did Jesus choose? He chose some dirty old fishermen. He knew fishermen to be crude and foul-mouthed, often impatient and hot-headed, but he chose 4 fishermen. He chose a tax collector. And everyone knew those people were swindlers. They were just greedy guys out to make money off everybody else's back. He chose a zealot, a fanatical revolutionary, and one who wanted all the tax collectors dead. Only made for some interesting conversation among the disciples, the tax collector and the zealot who preached that all tax collectors should be killed. And Jesus also chooses us, known sinners. Those of us who are all of us who have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, Jesus still chooses us. But there's a little difference between Jesus' team of poor players and Kevin's team, who at first wanted to win but then accepted it. But we know, because the Bible tells us, that Jesus' victory is already assured. It's already assured. There is nothing to worry about. There's no longer worrying about winning or losing if we're on Jesus' team, if we accept and become a friend of Jesus, if we agree to follow the commandment, love one another, just as Jesus has loved us. So it's about enjoying life, having fun in this process of loving one another. What was it that Jesus said? That my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. Filled with joy. Life abundant. That's what our friend Jesus offers to each and every one of us. Friendship. Recalling those definitions with which I began all this, I want to add one other insight. This is Charlie Brown's insight. Charlie Brown was standing all alone at one point, and he said this, and I quote, "A friend is someone who sticks up for you when you are not there." End quote. My friends, we were not there when Jesus died on that hill in Calvary, but he was sticking up for us. For you and for me. Anyway. Thanks be to God. Amen. Our hymn of response this morning is, of course, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus." It's found on page 630 of your hymns. So let us rise, either in body or in spirit, and sing together, "What a Friend We Have in Jesus."
Thank you. Descend upon us
and upon all who will be at your table this day and throughout this week. As we now gather around the table to commune with you and with one another, remind us that we are yours and that you will always be with us. As together we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. On that fateful night in that upper room when Jesus was gathered with his disciples around the table, as they began to share and fellowship with one another, Jesus took the bread, and after returning thanks for it, he broke it. And he told each of them, Take, eat, each of you, for this bread is my body, broken for you. Whenever you take of this bread, do this in remembrance of me. And he passed the bread around, and they each took some of it and partook, and then ate the rest of their meal together. And near the end of the meal, Jesus took the cup. And after returning thanks for the cup, he said to them, This cup represents the new covenant between you and your God. This cup represents my blood shed for each one of you. Whenever you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, this do in remembrance of me. And then Jesus shared the cup, and they all partook of that cup around the table as they communed with one another and with Jesus. My friends, the table has been prepared. You are now invited to partake of this table as the elders bring the elements to you. Remember, we will hold the bread when you receive it and all partake together to show our unity through Jesus Christ. And then the cup, we take at our own leisure to show our individual relationship, our friendship, if you will, with Jesus. May the elders now come forward. Thank you. throughout our lives and continue to do for us as well. Have a great week, this friend, my friends, and remember, regardless of what you're doing or where you're going, God is always with you. Because God is always above us, below us, behind us, and before us. God always stands right beside us. But most importantly of all, God is also inside us to bring us peace and joy. So go in peace this day, my friends. Amen.